Good morning, church. Good to see everybody. We have several that are out. I knew they were going to be out, but glad to see you and glad to have you as part of our worship service this morning. Do remember those folks that are traveling. Remember them in your prayers this week as we want them to return back to us safely. We passed out, as Jay said, power for today. Hopefully you've gotten those. Hopefully you've passed them out. Some of your friends, you might check with them the next week or two. See how they like it. See how they're enjoying it. See if they have any questions about it. And remind them to come and worship with us. We'd be glad to have them. There's a man, there's a reporter, a journalist, that was looking for a story, and he talked his editor into allowing him to go over into Israel and find different stories there and report back and to send those stories back. And so sure enough, he found a local, a native. He asked the man, he says, what do you do every day? The man says, well, I go to what we call in the United States and what other people call the Wailing Wall. Folks in Israel call it the Western Wall. You go to the Western Wall every day and I pray. Well, why? Well, that's considered where you offer up your prayers. And if you've gone there, I've not gone, but I've seen pictures and talked to people that have. You write a lot of times your prayers on little pieces of paper and you stick them in the cracks of the wall. And so the journalist, in talking to this man, said, well, you go every day. Yes, go every day, at least once, sometimes twice a day. And you stand there at a wall that's many feet taller than you, yes, and you pray. And so the journalist says, well, what do you pray for? And he says, well, pray for health, pray for my family, pray for world peace, pray for several things. And he listed a few more things. And the journalist said, well, how long have you been doing this? And he says, well, I've been doing it for about 25 years. And he said, so for 25 years, you've been asking God, if you will, to take care of your family, and you've been asking him to give world peace. And he says, well, how do you think that's going? And the man looked at the journalist and said, it's like talking to a wall. Have you ever felt that way in prayer? Have you ever felt like the psalmist in Psalm 10 says, why are you so far from me? And chapter 13 or the 13th Psalm, he says, why have you forsaken me? We pray to God and we pray often. We pray about many things. We pray about, excuse me, our families, their health. We pray about our safety. We pray about things with regards to the world. We pray with regards to world leaders, and we pray that world peace may abound. We pray, of course, for the church and for members, for those that are sick. We pray for our elders and our Bible school teachers, and hopefully you pray for your preacher. We pray for a great many things in our life, and so many times when we offer up those prayers, we wonder, is God listening? Because you see, it's been a long time since we've really seen or thought or think we've seen the answer to our prayers. You see, we wonder, why is God not answering our prayers? Why has God forsaken our prayers? Why is God not listening and responding in the way that I want to? Because you see, I prayed fervently last night, and this morning nothing's changed. I prayed for my health, and I woke up this morning and still had the same problems. The psalmist in Psalm 10, when he asked about, why are you so far off? Was in the midst of enemies. He's talking about there in that 10th Psalm, enemies. And why are you so far off? Why aren't you taking care of them? The 13th chapter, God, you've just forsaken me. You're not listening to what I have to say. You see, we offer up our prayers and we wonder why it is God delays. But when God delays in answering our prayers, the psalmist wondered, we have to understand a few things. We have to understand that that is part of it sometimes. But when God delays, there are certain things the Bible tells us that we should be aware of, be thankful for, and also participate in. When God delays, we have to understand that it may not be a no to our prayers. You see, we pray with confidence, don't we? In 1 John chapter 5 and verse 14, John tells us the confidence that we have of him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. we read that verse and we look at that verse and we think, oh man, this is the it. All I have to do is pray and I'll receive everything that I ask for. Well, the Bible does say, yeah, I'll give you a yes. That there are times in which pray, God says, I'll answer your prayers and I'll answer them just exactly as you prayed for them. I'll answer them in letting you know. The early church in Acts 12 prayed for the release of Peter, and it wasn't long before Peter was knocking at the door. They had received their prayer. And through the Bible, we can look at examples of those that received a yes, but we can also find that there were those that said received a no. Jesus would come to mind, at least at first, in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he asked the Lord, if there be any other way, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And Jesus was told, no, no, it's not happening. We think about Paul and his thorn in the flesh in 2 Corinthians 12, and the Lord said, no, my grace is sufficient for you. I'm not going to remove it. But then there are other times in which prayers are offered, and basically it's we just find out when we read it in the scriptures, we find out that God just says, well, wait a while. Just wait. And we don't like that answer, do we? I mean, that's like carrying a child to a candy store and then just saying, wait. No, you don't do that. Suzanne and I were blessed yesterday to go to the zoo with Ethan and Kara and Graceland. And right there, the zoo does what every other attraction does. They have a little store that you can go in. And for $10.95, you can get something that's worth about a dollar. Right, Chris? We had a marvelous time. Our time was so marvelous, we skipped that store. Graceland's small enough, we got to skip it. She didn't know what she was missing. But as we walked past it, there was one precious child. I wanted to take that child back in and buy that child something. But Mama told that child, you have your cotton candy. They had already bought that child something. Well, you see, we like that immediate gratification. We like that being told yes and being told right then. And if we don't get that, then in our mind, here's the answer. No. Right? Your boss ever told you you're going to get a raise? And 6 months later, you do? Well, they didn't tell you when, right? And probably that's what they would have said if you'd asked them. Well, we didn't tell you when. You're going to get one. In Jeremiah chapter 42, excuse me. In Jeremiah chapter 42, the prophet Jeremiah is approached by the children of Israel to pray to God for them. And in Jeremiah 42, Jeremiah reminds them in verse 7 that he has prayed for them. You skip down just a couple of verses. Jeremiah was asked. Jeremiah prayed, and the answer comes 10 days later. You see, this is not a new thing. The fact that God sometimes delays in his answer doesn't necessarily mean no. Sometimes it just means you just need to wait. It's not, as we'll see in a few minutes, it's not the right time. It's not the time in which everything has worked together for this answer. God sometimes delays, but that doesn't mean that you've received a no. You see, God is a patient God. In Romans chapter 15 and verse 5, he's called the God of all patience, and he has them. I'm not a person that is, as Suzanne, I'm not a very patient person. Our son, however, took after my father. He's a very patient young man, and I admire him for that. Want to thump his head every once in a while, but I admire him for that. God is patient. Let me give you an example. In 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 20, It said that in the days of Noah, God waited. Do you remember how long? 120 years. Now, best we can figure out, if you go back to the book of Genesis, and I did a lot of digging into this week, the best we can figure is that that is from the time God said that he was going to take man down because man was wicked and God, it made God sad that he had made man. And so he commissioned Noah to build the ark. The best we can tell from those that have studied chronology more than anything, some have said that it took Noah about 16 years to build the ark. Some said about 35 to 55. We don't know how long. Really, the Bible doesn't tell us, and all of that in many ways is a good guess or just a guess. But the Bible tells us that God waited for 120 years while Noah was preparing the ark. That's a patient God. Here's a God that looks down upon man and he's sickened that he's made man. Wished he hadn't. We're going to save the one that is righteous. We're going to save Noah because remember what it said? Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. We're going to save him. We're going to save his family. We're going to save the animals. And I was reminded yesterday through the zoo, so many animals look so much alike. I made the mistake of walking up and telling Graceland, look at the monkeys. And a lady corrected me. It's ape. Yes. And then I found out through the placard the difference. I learned something yesterday. But at the same point in time, too, God said, I'm going to save these animals. And so Noah prepared the ark. But at 120 years, whether it took Noah 120 years to literally build the ark, or whether that was just from the time God basically said, Noah, you're going to build the ark, to the time Noah finished, Peter says it took 120 years. Patience. Patience. But in God's patience, God is watching. In Malachi chapter 3, verse 3, the prophet Malachi says that God sits as a refiner and purifier of silver. Now, we know that an individual that is purifying silver has to watch the crucible of silver so that it doesn't get too hot or too cold. It has to remain at a certain temperature as it basically, as it heats up in order to make sure that all the impurities sink to the bottom. And as you skim it off, you're skimming off pure silver. It can't get too hot, it can't get too cold, and it has to remain at the temperature that is needed for a certain period of time. So the individual that is refining the silver has to watch the crucible very closely. Malachi the prophet says God sits looking at us as a refiner and a purifier of silver. He's watching us. And so God in his patience is watching us. He's watching to see what's going on with us. What do we do and how are we acting? How are we being? He's watching us to make sure that everything goes the way it should. Because you see, God is a God that wants to take care of us. Ezekiel 34, the prophet there is talking about himself, but he's likening himself unto a shepherd of sheep. Ezekiel 34, in many ways, has been applied to elders, and correctly so, but it's also an application of God and his sheep. And he says, I will seek my sheep, and I will search after them. I myself will seek my sheep, and I will search after them. A shepherd, we know, watches his sheep. He's in tune to his sheep. God says, I will watch my... Who's his sheep? We are. God watches us. And just because we receive what we think at that point in time when we pray a no does not mean that we've received a no. We're sort of got to remember the old story of the college professor that came in one day and told his class there is no God. And as he pontificated for some 45 minutes about the fact there is no God and gave all the reasons he believed why there is no God, he asked finally, he said, "Is there any Christian in this classroom now?" And one young girl raised her hand and said, "Yes, sir, I am." And so he said, "Let us pray." And his prayer was simply this: "God, if you're God and you exist," he said, "send down hell fire from heaven now and consume me." And he said a few other things. He ended his prayer. He looked at the young girl and he said, "See, it proves there is no God or he would have consumed me with fire." And she looked at him and she said, "What makes you think that in the little amount of time as you've been discussing this, that you can exhaust the patience of God that he would consume poor, miserable you?" And the teacher walked out defeated. The patience of God is long. The patience of God is long suffering. The patience of God is great, for God watches over us. And so when you receive a "wait a while," you see, you might say, "Well, our real problem is I don't know if I received a no or I received a wait a while." That's right. So, guess what comes into play? Matthew chapter 7, verse 7. "Ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened to you. Everyone that asks receives, to him that seeks finds, to him that knocks," what happens? It's opened. And the thing that is so hard to translate in those verses is the idea of continuous action. Keep asking, keep seeking, keep knocking. That's the idea that Jesus preached there on the Sermon on the Mount. You keep asking, you keep seeking, you keep knocking. You may feel like you're praying to all, but understand the patience of God. And as much as when God delays, it may not be a no to our prayers, we also have to know that God always acts in our best interest. God loves you. I don't care who you are. I don't care where your standard or standing is in life. I don't care if you're rich or poor. God doesn't care if you're black or white or you're some other nationality. God doesn't care if you're from America or from Russia. God doesn't care if you're young or old. God doesn't care if you're sickly or non-sickly. God doesn't care. God loves you. Now to our Lord Jesus Christ and God our Father, who loved us and gave us everlasting consolation in Jesus Christ. 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 16. God who loves us. God loves us. That's important. We sang about it. Steve sang about it. Didn't ask for that song, but it so fit so well with the sermon this morning. God does love us. And in that love that God has for us is a love that wants to see us succeed. You see, the Bible talks about success. Joshua chapter 1, Joshua is commissioned by God. Joshua is going to lead the children of Israel. Now, not literally, but figuratively, the children of Israel had led Moses crazy. I mean, you know, they had tried him at every point, twist and turn. Joshua now, the successor, handpicked successor, follows Moses. He's reminded to be strong and be of good courage. But then he's reminded, the book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate upon it day and night. And he also says that you may prosper. That's verse 8. Last part of verse 9. As he tells him, don't turn from it to the right hand or the left. You know how he ends that verse? And you shall have success. Verse 8, he says you're going to prosper. Verse 9, he says you're going to have success. Now we turn over the pages of the New Testament. And we turn over to one verse that in many ways is one of my favorite. 1 John chapter 5, verse 4. This is the victory that overcomes the world. Our faith. We win. We're victors. God wants to see us succeed. And the answer is, and the reality of it is that we do and we will. Well, go back to Joshua chapter 1 for a minute. How do we do that? Well, Joshua was told, stay with the Word of God. Don't deviate from it. Don't venture away from it. Don't move to the right hand or the left. Stay with the Word of God. As you stay with the Word of God, you'll prosper. You'll have success. Yes, I know. Success to us is money. Success to us is houses. Success to us is things. And if we have those things, whether it be money, a lot of money in our bank account, whether it be the idea that we're well-funded in through our stocks and our portfolios and our mutual funds, whether it be the fact that we have big houses, whether it be the fact that we have lots of stuff, we say, then we're a success. Then we've been successful. You can have those things and not be successful. You're successful by world standards. And there's nothing wrong with it as long as you're using it for the glory of God. But it is success that is found when God, through the Lord, separates the sheep from the goats. And you hear, well done, good and faithful servant. That's success. That's the success that God wants for you. It's not necessary that everybody drive the biggest car that can be found and put it out on the church parking lot. That's not what he's saying. That everybody has $1,000 suits, that everybody has $1,000 dresses and shoes to match and all of the things and paraphernalia that goes along with all of those things. You may have those. God may have blessed you that way, and that's fine. But yet at the same point in time, too, victory. From God's standpoint, it's well done. God wants to see you have that success. God wants to see you be of His righteous. And so when we pray to God and we wonder why in the world is it taking God so long to answer our prayers, we have to understand that God is looking out in our best interest. And we have to understand that sometimes, wanting us to have that victory, He works out His providence. Yeah, Romans 8:28 passage that all things work together for good comes to an understanding through the idea of years. Think about this. Good old Joseph in the Old Testament was about 17 years old when his brother sold him into slavery. He's 28, it's believed, when he interprets the dream of the butler and the baker. He's 30, it's believed, when he interprets the dream for Pharaoh. It's 37. He's 37 now, mind you, when all of a sudden the good years of plenty have come, and he has successfully led in Pharaoh's court. He has successfully led the storage of grain for this next 7 years of famine. And he's 39 when his family comes knocking at the door and says, we need food. Did you catch that? When did that all start? When he was 17. Did you catch that when it finished, so to speak? He's 39. Wasn't the next day, was it? It took time. Think about the story of Paul. Christy was supposed to remind me of the story of Paul. She did. The story of Paul found especially the last part of the book of Acts. Think about how Paul said he wanted to go to Rome. Well, when you read Acts 21, it starts really, this part of it starts in Acts 21, 22, 23, 24. When you read that last part of the book of Acts, you see Paul's wanting to go to Rome. Well, Paul gets there, but think about how he gets there. He, first of all, he's tried. Trumped up charges are made against him. He's tried. He's carried to Caesarea Philippi. Why? Because he is put in Roman jail for 2 years. He eventually is out because, you know why? He says, I'm a Roman. And he appeals to Caesar. And so they put him on a boat. It doesn't go well. Go back and read the last part of the book of Acts. It doesn't go well. They put him in on the boat fall. It's spring before he gets there. And like I say, the trip doesn't go well. Remember the time in which he everybody else is afraid, and Paul comes up and he says, we'll all be in Rome. We'll be safe. The Lord has told me. He says, God told me and I believe it. It's going to happen. That's that story. And Paul eventually ends up in Rome. Didn't happen overnight. He'd asked the Lord several times. He'd wanted to go. God eventually worked it out. But he worked it out in his own time. Remember what Paul wrote to the church of Galatia in Galatians chapter 4 with regards to Jesus? In the fullness of time, God sent forth his son, made of a woman. In the fullness of time. Here's another way of saying this. At the right, perfect time. Now think about this. Creation is when God told Satan it's going to happen. Several thousand years later. We've figured the world's about, if you figure the world's 10,000 years old, you figure back, you say, well, okay, that took about 6,000 years. You do a little math. Yeah. And when the fullness of time came, when the right time came, God sent his son. You see, God is always acting, but when he acts in our best interest. Why? Because he wants to see us succeed. He wants to see us to hear the words, well done. And so here's our answer. Our answer is twofold. Our answer is, first of all, God is at the right place at the right time, doing exactly what he should do. We see that exemplified by Jesus. In John the 11th chapter, remember here we're towards the end of Jesus' life, really. And Jesus gets there and he gets to the home of Lazarus, and Lazarus is dead. And remember, his sister comes out and tells Jesus, if you'd been here, he wouldn't have died. Where was Jesus? He was at the right place doing the right thing at the right time. And when he got there at the right time, what did he do? He raised Lazarus from the dead. That's God. He's at the right place at the right time doing the right things, with the result being the right thing in your life and in my life as well. But knowing that that's our God, we have to then ultimately, Psalm 37 and verse 7, to rest or trust in the Lord and wait patiently. We have to be individuals that really trust in the Lord and wait patiently. Best illustrated by an old country church years ago. An old man one time was asked, Brother Joe, will you lead prayer? And Brother Joe started out, Lord, you know I don't like buttermilk, but it's all right. And Lord, you know I hate lard, but it's all right. And about that time, you know, a few eyes were beginning to go, bling, bling, bling. They were opening up, and the preacher was getting really itchy. And he said, Lord, you know I don't like flour. And the preacher was really getting excited because he was afraid. He thought, where is this man going with this prayer? He said, but that's all right. He said, but Lord, when you mix that buttermilk and you mix that flour and you mix it all up, he said, those biscuits, oh, Lord, we love them. They are so good. And he said, Lord, just keep mixing our life because we know it's going to turn out good, whatever happens. And so when God delays, we have to remember he's always acting in our best interest. But then that reminds us then that we need to understand that in this delay of answering our prayers, that God is really offering us opportunities to grow. You see, immediate gratification is wonderful. Immediate gratification is good. I mean, you know, I walk in sometimes in the evening and ask Suzanne what's for supper, and immediately my mouth begins to water. because I know how she fixes it. I know how it's going to taste, and I know it's going to be good. She's a good cook. But I have to wait sometimes till she finishes. Sometimes I have to get in there with her and help stir the pot. Now, that's about all I can do, but I'll stir the pot. In our prayer life, we have to remember sometimes this waiting, it gives us time. It gives us time, first of all, to really keep asking. It gives us time to spend time studying His Word and looking at His Word and finding those scriptures that are so important, that help us through our struggles, that help us through our times, and causes us then ultimately to reach to God again in prayer and to pray more and pray harder, realizing that that's who we're depending upon. Jeremiah was right. Oh, Lord, we know that the way of man is not in himself. It's not in man that walks to direct his steps. He realizes it's God. And that delay gives us that opportunity to see the whole picture as He has seen it, to understand that it's really Him and it's not us, to understand that He's the one that has blessed us with the blessings that we have, and it has not been the fact that we have done it. Solomon said in Ecclesiastes 7 and verse 3, sorrow is better than laughter. And we look at that and we think Solomon has lost his mind. But Solomon, in saying that sorrow is better than laughter, says sad countenance of the heart is better. It makes it better. When you go through struggles, they're not fun. They're not easy. But when you get on the other side and you're looking back over all of a sudden and you see the hand of God and what God has done, you're able to praise Him for what He's done. So James was out of work. He was out of work for what ended up being 15 months. It was not a time of great prosperity in the nation at that time. It was also not a time of great employment like we have right now. And Joe went everywhere, did everything he could to find a job. And finally, one place, and he had to go through three interviews, finally hired him. When Joe was hired, he went and talked to the preacher one Sunday. He told him, he said, these were hard months. We didn't have much money. We didn't know if we was going to make it. I didn't know if I was even going to find a job. But he said, they have been 15 great months. And the preacher kind of shook his head in kind of amazement. And he says, how do you figure? And he said, well, we've become a better family, a stronger family, a more loving family. We've spent more time reading and studying the Bible and meditating upon those things than we had ever before. And we plan to continue that. And we have prayed. I have prayed so hard. And God has now answered my prayer. He said, we're better for the experience. Muscles grow when what? When you use them. Sometimes our spiritual muscles need to grow when we use them. And in using them, what happens? We draw closer to God. A God that has told us that such chastening of the Lord, while at present is not joyful, it's grievous. But afterwards, it works the peaceable fruits of righteousness. It works what God wants it to. For my brethren, James says, count it all joy when you fall into various temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith works patience. James says, difficulty? Yeah. It works patience. It works what's good for our light affliction, which is but for a moment. works in us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things that are seen, but the things that are not seen. For the things that are seen are temporal. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17. Following. In your delay, know that God's just letting you grow a little bit. Habakkuk chapter 2 is an interesting verse. In Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 20, there's a song that goes to this verse. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent before him. We've used that verse through the years to call people to worship. But go back to the text. The book of Habakkuk is a book in which the prophet is wondering, children of Israel have gone way far from God. And Habakkuk just simply wonders, God, how long are you going to let this happen? And the prophet comes to an understanding as he talks with and talks about God to the children of Israel to the last verse in chapter 2. And then chapter 3 is a great revealing, if you will. I won't spoil it for you. Go back and study it. But Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 20 says, I know where the Lord is. He hadn't left. He hasn't forsaken us. He hasn't forgotten about us. He hasn't turned off his hearing to us. He's where he always has been. He's where he needs to be. He's where he's supposed to be. And he's all working it out for our good. For the Lord is in his temple. Let all the earth keep silent before him. Keep praying, folks. You may not get exactly what you want. You may not get it right now when you pray, but keep praying. God will bless you. This morning, if you're not his child, you need to put his son, our Savior, on baptism for the remission of your sins, or you need to rededicate your life. Won't you come? All together, we stand and sing.